Emanuel Swedenborg was a career scientist when the Lord called him to be a revelator. An expert investigator, he was well prepared for the job. At that time, religion was a meaningful part of daily life, but as scientists explored new frontiers, many struggled to see how God the Creator fit in with his creation. Emanuel took an active part in this debate. As a young man, he sought the boundaries of God's creation by exploring the origin of the solar system. Later, he searched for the soul in the human body and examined the body's systems. But at age 55, his quest changed. He left his home in Sweden to publish books in Holland. As he passed through Germany, he requested an audience with Sweden's newly chosen crown prince so he could proudly show off his books. When he arrived in Holland, his days were spent preparing manuscripts for publication. But powerful night visions increasingly made him aware of God's close presence, and also of his own faults. He realized he was egotistical, that he had not loved others, but only himself. And he wept. As his dreams became more vivid, he began to see that the Word of God was more real than the world around him. Emmanuel's heart was changing. One night, as he prayed to be worthy of the Lord's grace, a hand squeezed his hands, and the Lord appeared to him, face to face. When the Lord asked if he had a clean bill of health, he replied, "Lord, you know better than I." From that time, the Lord opened his mind more and more to the realm of the Spirit. He prayed for the Lord to lead him, to become as a child, to become the Lord's humble servant. The Lord appeared to Emmanuel again, more clearly, and commissioned him to unfold the spiritual meaning of the word. He promised that he himself would explain what to write. After accepting this call, Emmanuel could speak with spirits and angels while fully awake. It was a huge turning point. He immediately stopped all scientific work and began to train as a scientist of the Spirit. He studied Hebrew and Greek. He read the Bible and jotted insights in the margins. His next book was filled with poetic imagery. It presented a grand circle of creation in which God's love formed nature and was returned to God through people. He researched prophecies of the Messiah and examined creation from the Creator's point of view. As his knowledge of the Bible and its spiritual meaning grew, he explained the law and the prophets. During this time, he wrote 5,000 pages, but published nothing. He was still working for the Board of Mines, and in fact was chosen to be the president of the board. His colleagues had no idea of the changes taking place in him. Instead of accepting the promotion, he asked to retire, to devote himself to his new work. He traveled to Holland, intending to publish an explanation of the Bible, but decided instead to write an index of key words in the Bible. As a scientist, he had speculated about other worlds and space. Now he was entering more and more deeply into a different new world, the world of the Spirit, as a spiritual explorer. He moved to London, ready to make a fresh start at explaining the Bible. His new work, Secrets of Heaven, was written in clear, simple Latin. He published it anonymously. Like all the books he'd go on to publish, it was informed by his spiritual experiences. He didn't hide his experiences, but said, "I have seen, I have heard, I have felt." At times, the spiritual world was more present to him than the natural world. Several times, he was in such deep conversation with spirits that he found he'd walked from city to country without knowing how he'd done it. Sometimes people heard him talking in his room, as if he was in conversation, but for the most part, people had no idea he talked to spirits. He never mentioned it. When home in Sweden, Emanuel loved gardening. He imported seeds from all over the world. He grew tulips and boxwood bushes from Holland, and dogwoods and corn from America. He overwintered foreign plants and birds from his large outdoor birdhouse in the attic of his home. He often used his garden to entertain and would lead guests to see new additions, like a pavilion or a rose garden. He created a maze where children could play and built a mirror house. He would open the doors to show guests his other garden, which he said was more beautiful than his own. Greta Askbaum, a neighbor, once asked her Uncle Swedenborg to show her an angel. He stood her before a curtain, and when he drew it aside, she saw herself reflected in the mirror. He built a library and a summer house to use in warm weather. Although Emanuel's house no longer stands, his summer house is in a museum in Stockholm. Emanuel's organ is there too. He loved music. He'd go to concerts and afterwards come home and play tunes he had heard on the organ. After finishing 8 volumes of Secrets of Heaven, Emanuel witnessed a judgment in the spiritual world that opened the way for a new Christianity. Then he published 5 short books in quick succession. He was in Gothenburg after one of his trips when William Castell, a merchant, invited him to dinner. At 6 o'clock, Emanuel became agitated. He knew a fire was burning in his neighborhood in Stockholm, 300 miles away. It had destroyed a friend's house and was threatening his house. At 8 o'clock, he relaxed. The fire had stopped 3 doors from his home. Emmanuel's description of the fire immediately became the talk of the town. The provincial governor summoned Emanuel to find out the details of the disaster he had seen. Messengers from Stockholm arrived the next day with news of the fire, confirming the details exactly as Emanuel had seen them. People began to guess Emanuel had written the books about the spiritual world. Some asked if they could speak to people who had died, but Emanuel refused to use his spiritual sight lightly, saying that the Lord had forbidden it. 6 years later, as he passed through Gothenburg again, Johann Rosen, a doctor of theology, invited him to dinner. He and his colleague, Dr. Gabriel Beyer, enjoyed their conversation so much that they asked him to dine again the following day. Dr. Beyer asked Emanuel to write a summary of the new doctrines for him. The next day, his eyes brimming with tears of joy, Emanuel gave Dr. Beyer the summary and told him he'd been introduced to a community of angels and was now surrounded by them. Beyer was among the first to accept the new revelation. Almost 10 years passed before Emanuel claimed authorship of his books. He put Emanuel Swedenborg, a Swede, on the title page of Married Love. He listed the books he'd published anonymously on the last page. Johan Kuno, a wealthy Amsterdam merchant, read Married Love and wanted to meet Emanuel. The two became friends, and Kuno often invited him to visit. When he talked, Kuno said, it was as if truth itself was speaking from his smiling blue eyes. Kuno did not always agree with Emanuel, but spoke his mind, knowing Emanuel would listen. He called him a true friend, a man you can trust in the dark. Emanuel penned his last words at this table in London. His landlords, the Sharesmiths, said their lodger was appreciative and needed little. Usually he went to bed early without supper, but once in a while he worked all night, asking not to be disturbed. He loved black coffee with lots of sugar. For dinner, he enjoyed a roll with hot milk and occasionally ate eels or pigeon pie. Reflecting on his role as a revelator, he wrote, "The Lord showed himself before me, his servant, and sent me to this work. From the first day of that call, I have not received the doctrines from any angel, but from the Lord alone while I have read the word." Months before dying, Emanuel predicted the date of his death. On March 29th, 1772, he heard the clock chime and asked what time it was. On hearing 5 o'clock, he said, "That is good. I thank you. God bless you." And died. Emanuel's scientific training prepared him for a spiritual mission he never imagined or sought. Yet he willingly responded to a call to travel to the realm of the spirit and report in detail what he heard and saw. His theological works have influenced and continue to influence many fields of thought. For some, they are the basis for a new Christianity.